Here to introduce to you our speaker for today in our One Center Circle of Thought series, Professor Tyrone Howard. Professor Howard is an associate professor at UCLA in the Graduate School of Education and Information Studies, Urban Schooling Division. He is also director of Center X, which is a consortium of urban school professionals working towards social justice and educational equity in transforming Los Angeles schools. He is also the director and founder of the Black Male Institute at UCLA, which is an interdisciplinary cadre of scholars, practitioners, community members, and policymakers dedicated to improving the educational experiences and life chances of Black males. Now, Professor Howard's research is primarily concerned with academic achievement of youth in urban schools. His work has centered on the achievement gap facing African Americans and other culturally diverse students, and the importance of providing teachers the skills and knowledge to assist them in reversing persistent underachievement. Dr. Howard has been a member of the UCLA faculty for the past 10 years. Prior to his tenure here at UCLA, he was a faculty member in the College of Education at The Ohio State University. Before entering higher education, Dr. Howard was a classroom teacher in the Compton Unified School District. A native of Compton, California, Dr. Howard is one of the foremost experts on race, culture, teaching, and learning in urban schools. His new book, Race, Culture, and the Achievement Gap, published by Teachers College Press, examines the roles that race and culture play in educational outcomes. Professor Howard is a frequent contributor on National Public Radio and is also a contributor to the New York Times Educational Issues Forum. Dr. Howard was recently awarded an Early Career Award by the American Educational Research Association, which is the nation's largest and most prestigious educational research organization, for his work on equity and access to urban schools. I should also note that Professor Howard has been a member of the Faculty Advisory Committee here at the One Center, including its chair, as well as the chair of QARS, which is the committee that sets admissions policy here at UCLA. Today he's going to speak on the state of African American education in a post-racial era, promise or peril. Dr. Howard.
Thanks a lot. Appreciate you coming here. Good afternoon, everybody. How are y'all feeling? Appreciate to see so many friendly faces out here. I know we got Anita Hill here, so I was up against stiff competition, so I appreciate you all being loyal. But thanks for the introduction, Darnell, and Alex has been talking to me for seems like years for making this happen, so persistence pays off. So I'm glad to have the opportunity to be here with you all today, see these familiar faces and friendly faces. So I want to spend some time today talking about this state of African-American education and really problematizing some things I've been trying to wrap my head around. So I'm still trying to come to grips with this, and so I'm hoping that my talking and sharing it with you today will give you an opportunity to see where my thinking is trying to go, but also wanting to hear from some of you as well to kind of help sort of push back about some of the things I want to share this afternoon. And I talk about this because I think what happens in all disciplines, but in particular in education, there are these narratives that exist. And these narratives come to fruition based on ideology, based on beliefs, sometimes informed, other times uninformed. But what happens is that these narratives become reified and they become set in stone. And what happens is that even those of us who do this work become really sort of connected, or we buy in deeply to what these narratives say about different types of phenomena. And so one of the narratives I want to try to problematize a bit today is the ways in which we look at the state of educational affairs for African American students. And so I want to touch real briefly on these three narratives that tend to exist and then offer counter narratives of how I think we should begin to raise some questions about whether or not these narratives are accurate for a 2013 context. And I raise this because I think narratives oftentimes are informed by data that supports them, but I think if they're not complete, the narratives can be misleading. And because the narratives can be misleading, I think there's a need to offer a counter-narrative that would help to challenge that. So I want to kind of walk through these real quickly just to kind of show you where I'm going and where I'm trying to wrap my head around. So I think one of the narratives that exists is this idea that Black children attended poorly funded, under-resourced, and inferior schools prior to integration. That's the narrative that has existed for a long period of time. And part of what I want to do is push back on that narrative, because while we do know that schools prior to integration were not funded at rates equal to their white counterparts, but the idea that those schools were inferior, I think, is one that can and should be challenged. And there are a number of works that document this. You look at James Anderson's work on blacks in the South. He talks about the ways in which black families, black churches, black schools were full of resilience, full of commitment, and really pushed back against the idea that black children could not learn. But that oftentimes is missing from the narrative, because the narrative tells us that these were just poorly funded, poorly staffed schools, and I think we need to tell the fuller story there, okay? The second narrative that tends to exist is that once black students had access to integrated schools, their experiences and their outcomes improved. Hence, the interpretation becomes when black children were able to be educated with white students, things were much better for them. So it seems to take away the sense of agency of black children and black families and tends to put the spotlight on what happens in such a benevolent fashion in terms of being able to go to school with white children. I think the counter narrative to that has to be the fact that it wasn't necessarily access to white students that helped to improve outcomes and experience for black children, but it was a further commitment on the part of black families to ensure that black children had access to a higher level of education. So I want to talk more about that in a minute. But the third one I really want to challenge is this idea that we hear today, the narrative that exists that tells us that black children trail white, Asian, and Latino students on most, in some cases, all academic indices. So we hear it all the time, be it the achievement gap, the opportunity gap, the education debt, and I want to be clear about the fact that there are lots of data that support this notion. I'm going to unpack some of that in a moment. But what I'm really starting to push back on is I think the narrative becomes so reified and so ingrained in our minds that black children can't, black children don't, black children are unable to, that when there's evidence that suggests that black children can, that seems to get lost in the equation. And I think that if we want to develop a counter-narrative, we have to begin to highlight those cases and examples where you have black children who defy the odds and who do not fall into this particular narrative. Now, let's try to disrupt some of these narratives. So I mentioned the first counter-narrative. Prior to integration, blacks did attend schools that were funded at lower levels. However, the idea that they were inferior is a flawed argument. I would recommend that all of you take a look at Vanessa Siddle Walker's work, where she talks about the commitment that black families and black churches and black communities made to ensure that black children still had access to high quality education, and that you had educated scholars, educated teachers, even in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s, who were some of the most highly skilled, highly trained educators who worked in segregated schools. That is oftentimes missing from the narrative. What Siddle Walker also unpacks is the kind of financial commitment and investment that poor black families made at the time. While they were already being assessed a tax by their local counties, they also had double taxes where they were willing to put in additional taxes to the supporting and the uplifting of their institutions. So I think that has to be part of the argument, that there was always a sense of black agency that ensured that black children had something better than what the government was willing to offer at the time, okay? The second counter-narrative, as I mentioned, the idea that blacks students did experience improved outcomes post-segregation. However, the variable that typically comes out is the fact that, you know, the idea that black students had access to better schools, better teachers, and better students around them. But part of what's missing is this idea that what happens, you had increased government spending in poor neighborhoods, in the war on poverty. So for the first time, we began to see some offset of the inequities that existed between schools and neighborhoods where black students attended and their white counterparts. Investment in urban schools, Head Start programs, and core entitlements were enhanced. All these were parts of the equation, not the idea that just being in classrooms with white children was somehow some kind of magical elixir that helped black children perform better. And then I think this third point, which is important here, is the idea that increased access to post-secondary options for blacks helped to improve the overall quality for black students, black families, and black communities. So that becomes part of the counter-narrative. But I want to be clear, so as I try to help to sort of challenge this idea that the narrative that we have been operating on is flawed, I don't want to dismiss the fact that there are still some realities that are quite disturbing, quite unsettling, that we have to begin to unpack. But again, those should be part of the narrative as opposed to the entire narrative, okay? So, you all know these data, right? And I think this becomes part of the narrative where we consistently hear about where black children perform, right? And so you look at NAEP scores, black students are consistently at the bottom of the barrel when it comes to reading. This is one of the most, I think, important indices that tell us where black children underperform. So we need to understand that there's still some institutional barriers in place, structural challenges that continue to contribute to the kinds of ways in which black children experience schools very different. The fact that we have over 80% of black children, according to NAEP data, not reading at grade level poses some serious concerns that we have to unpack and address. However, what's oftentimes missing from our analysis is what happens with this 14% of black students who are performing well? Why don't we talk about them? How are they performing? Where is their discourse as a part of the larger narrative, right? Sometimes, and for understandable reasons, we focus on the larger percentage of those students who are not doing well, but I think we do so to the neglect of understanding that there are those who are disrupting the narrative, okay? Math scores tell us the same thing. What we see is NAEP data begins to unpack the idea that black students consistently fall behind their white, their Latino, and their Asian counterparts. And there's all kind of data that backs this up. And I want to be clear about it's important to name these kinds of discrepancies, to identify where the gaps exist, because it's got to be work that helps us to begin to address these disparities. Again, you look at areas of, and this is, I think, where data really becomes powerful in terms of telling the narrative. You look at overall percentages that black students make in schools, 16% of students who are in schools, 6% of students who are identified as gifted and talented. I have maintained for a long time we need to rethink the definitions of what gifted and talented are. I think we have operated on a very narrow paradigm that has defined gifted and talented in ways that oftentimes tends to sort of push up against the very cultural norms and ways of knowing that black children bring to schools. But I think these numbers present some really disturbing sort of realities when you look at the fact that black children, while only 6% of those who are identified as gifted and talented are over a third or close to a third of those who are in categories that are labeled as mentally retarded or students who are suspended in schools. So severely overrepresented when it comes to areas such as suspensions and expulsions, but severely underrepresented when it comes to gifted types of classes and things of that sort. And then you look at Asian students, 4% of the population, yet grossly overrepresented when it comes to their placement in gifted programs and classes, and underrepresented when it comes to their placement in suspensions, expulsions, and placement in special education. So again, the idea becoming that there are some challenges that we have to sort of continue to push up against when it comes to what happens in schools for children of color. Students who are suspended in middle school, we again see that black males are suspended at a higher rate than any other subgroup of students in schools. I think there's a lot to be said about what are some of the challenges there. We continue to have a large number of teachers who are just culturally ignorant around the kinds of ways of knowing, ways of being, ways of expression that black boys bring to schools, and that's a big part of that. But I think what's oftentimes missing from our narrative is that we have black females who aren't too far behind, and they still remain the second largest group of students who are being suspended in schools. So we have to begin to ask ourselves, what is happening in schools that black children oftentimes engaging in the same type of behavior but being treated very differently by their teachers and administrators, okay? Now, so here's one that continues to raise some concern when you look at SAT scores, and the College Board has continued to put this data out, which I think causes some alarm. Because oftentimes I get the argument that says this is not a racial issue, it's a socioeconomic issue. And so if it were a socioeconomic issue, I think the data here would begin to sort of support that narrative. So what the College Board does is they look at black students, Latino students, and white students, but what you notice here is that they begin to really problematize the idea of class. So if you look at average SAT scores, according to the College Board, black students who come from families have incomes in excess of $100,000 or more, there's a mean score of 1420. Which seems to be, it's below the national average, but still not nearly as high of a score as you would expect to see for black children who are coming from schools where their families do relatively well, $100,000 or higher. Same thing for Latino students. If you look at the College Board data, family incomes that are over $100,000, those students perform at about 1,500 on the SAT. Not quite where we want to see those numbers. Compared to what is required to get in some of the most selective colleges and universities across the country. But what's disturbing about these data is that the College Board also looks at these numbers compared to white students who have family incomes of $20,000 and less. Okay, so we're looking at well-to-do black and brown kids and comparing them with very poor white children. And we see that those numbers are a bit disturbing. So poor white kids outperform well-to-do black and brown kids. So this is why we have to continue to examine issues around how racial disparities are very much a part of what happens in schools today. If this were strictly a class analysis, we would see well-to-do black and brown kids outperforming poor white kids. And the reality is, if you're of any ethnic or racial background, and you come from a household income of $20,000 or less, that means you oftentimes attend very poorly funded schools, tend to have access to lower quality teachers. But the fact that these students still outperform well-to-do black and brown students raises some questions that have been a part of the narrative. But again, the idea we have to push upon is that we have some other aspects of this narrative that need to be told. Now, let's look at the University of California, where we all attend, right? So part of my challenge is that this still persists at the college level. So let's look at the overall percentage of students who graduate across each of the non-UCs here. We don't have enough data here from Merced to talk about this. So you see overall graduation rates here. UC does a relatively good job in terms of graduating students compared to most colleges and universities. So here at UCLA, we graduate about 90% of our students within a 5 to 6 year period. Yanina, if I'm wrong, correct me on this, okay? I'm right, okay, good. But what is disturbing is that the devil's always in the details. And so as you begin to sort of disaggregate the data and look closer at subgroups, you see some disparities here. And what you see here at UCLA, this is where we've got to do a better job. African-American males have a much lower graduation rate compared to the overall population, about a 24-point disparity between the overall population and this particular subgroup. But we're not the only ones who have this challenge. You look at Berkeley, theirs is more significant than ours. Close to 90% of their students graduate. Only 62% of their black males graduate. Davis has the same problem. I take personal interest in this one because I have a son at Davis, so I want to see what's happening here. 65% of black males graduate compared to 80% of the overall population. UC Irvine has the same kind of reality. Again, we can continue to go down. Even at UC Riverside, the numbers are not as great. However, what we see is the overall graduation rate is not as high. So we have to ask ourselves the question, what is taking place at universities that do a good job of educating students across the board? However, these numbers are where they are. Now, in fairness to what the UC does, these numbers for African-American males are significantly higher here than they are for the national average. If you look at the national average, black males graduate at a rate of about 43-45% nationally. So I think we have to sort of complexify these numbers from the standpoint that UC does a better job than most institutions do, but at the same time, it's clear that there's not enough that's happening here to get these numbers closer to where they should be here on this side. That makes sense to folks? Same thing, we unpack the numbers for African-American women. Not as pronounced as they are for African-American men, but there's still discrepancies. We see that UCLA, again, and Berkeley continue to have the biggest discrepancies in terms of the overall number of students, the percentage of students who graduate compared to the numbers here. We would like to see in an ideal way these numbers being consistent. So if we're graduating 90% of all students, we would hope to see that 90% of African-American women are graduating. Or if we see 90% of students graduating, that 90% of African-American men are graduating. So part of what we have to unpack is that in the narratives that get told, there's always some ways in which a counter-narrative has to be offered. And some of the work we've been doing, and Brian is here and some other folks who are here, Bria is here, who have been doing this work, have been looking at and identifying ways we can put in interventions that begin to offer a different set of experience that allow these students to see their graduation rates increase at levels that can be comparable to what we see for the overall campus population. Make sense to folks? All right, now, what is absent from the narrative? And this is where I'm trying to struggle to sort of wrap my head around how do we sort of move away from seeing all the data that is not as positive as we would like for it to be. So now, what we know is that in 2012, there were 3.5 million African Americans with bachelor's degrees in this country. That is oftentimes missing from our conversation, missing from our narrative, right? And so I ask the question, why? Because if that continues to remain absent from the narrative, the takeaway point becomes that most black folks don't have degrees, or all black folk don't have degrees, right? And I think there's got to be a shift in this conversation. We know 1.3 have a master's degree. About a quarter of a million, less than a quarter of a million hold professional degrees, and 224,000 African Americans have earned doctorates. So when you total these numbers, what we know is that there are 5 million people, black folk in this country, who have at least bachelor's degrees. That is rarely part of our conversation, not part of the discourse. And part of what we have to begin to ask ourselves is, what is it that worked for these 5 million folks, and how can it be replicated? How do we begin to expand the opportunity in some ways that more folk have access to this? I say all this because here's the take-home point. In many ways, when you talk about the state of education for African Americans, I would argue that in some ways it's the best of times, but at the same time, it's also the worst of times. We have such a widespread disparity between those who gain access to education and those who do not gain access. And part of what I want us to understand is that we look at a lot of data that looks at the outcomes across racial groups, but I think there's a need for us to look at data within racial groups. Because if we do that, we begin to recognize that there's some quite some disturbing distinctions there. I don't know, and there's data that supports this, I don't know if we've ever had a period of time in our history where the gap between the haves and the have-nots of black folks have been as distinct as it is. We've always had disparities within group, but never before have we had so many folks who have access, opportunity, but at the same time, folks who have not. So for example, we know that there's over 109,000 African-American millionaires in this country, yet there are 10 million black folks who live below the poverty line. We have 5 million folks who have college degrees, but we have 10 million folks who don't have high school diplomas, right? The discrepancies are startling in lots of ways that we have not begun to unpack and to begin to take a closer look at why do we see these discrepancies, and most importantly, what do these folks do, or what responsibility do these folks have to somehow disrupt the set of circumstances that we see for those who don't have, okay? That might get a little unsettling in here, because I think I want to throw a challenge out to us here about what our role should be, okay? Black household incomes. Again, what we see here is that in 2010 census data, that black household has a median of $32,068. That is disturbing, because the national poverty level is about $22,000, $23,000. Yet that's our median income as a group of people, right? What we know is that a third of black folks live below the poverty line. One third. We have the largest percentage of folks who live below poverty than any other group of folks in this country. But again, I always ask us to turn this on its head to say, if we have a third who are living below the poverty line, what is happening with the two-thirds who are not below poverty, right? How can we understand their set of experiences? We have to disrupt the narrative, because the narrative becomes one where we constantly think that all black folks are in poverty. Not to discount the fact that we have a higher percentage who are than others, but what about those who are not in this particular situation, right? So just to break this down further, we know about a little more than a quarter have household income between $25,000 and $50,000. 15% earn between $50,000 and $75,000, 7.6% between $75,000 and $100,000, and 9.4% earn more than $100,000. So the key here is to look at this 15 to 16% who seem to be doing well, right? Almost consistent with that 14% that I showed on an earlier slide of those children who are reading at above grade level. So what we see is when students have access early on to education, it opens lots of doors for them down the line. And there's all kinds of correlations that we see between education, income, and wealth. So part of what we have to see, if this is a civil rights issue, it's more than a civil rights issue. In some ways, it's a human rights issue, because when people have access to education, the entire quality of their life changes substantially compared to those who do not. That's what I want us to sort of have as part of this conversation. The counter narrative also tells us that when we look at schools, we hear that black children don't have access to AP. That is true. However, what we see is that the number of students who do have access to AP has been increasing significantly. That's not part of our conversation. What we know is that in the early 90s, blacks were very low in terms of the numbers who were taking AP courses and AP exam. That number has begun to increase steadily over the last two decades. Now blacks make up close to 7.5% of all students who take AP courses in high school. At one point, that number was close to 1%, 1.5%. So something is happening that we have to talk about in terms of who gets access. By no means is my argument that this number is enough. I think it should be much higher, but what we have to do is recognize where the progress has occurred and to look at some of the factors that were in place as to what led to that increase. Now, my argument is on each of these sort of areas of improvement, I'm not a believer that says that I think that one day folks woke up and said we should just do the right thing on behalf of black children. I think these changes have occurred because there has been a push. These changes have occurred because there have been folks who have raised issues around equity. These changes have occurred because folks who have had access have found ways to implement policy, programs, and the like that say that something different has to happen for African American students. The bottom line, though, is if this is going to continue, it's going to require ongoing pressure, ongoing pushing from folks who have had access, as opposed to the idea of folks who do have access not fighting the fight in ways that they fought for many years. So Ivory Tolson does some phenomenal work. So I'm trying to find different works that disrupt the narrative, okay? So here's one narrative. So the narrative that comes about is that single-parent households are broken, right? How many times have we heard that narrative, right? So if you come from a single-parent household, that means somehow something is not right about your household. But what Tolson's work looks at is that when we talk about single-parent households, especially within the black context, the idea has been that children who commit crimes come from single-parent households. But what his data unpacks is the fact that crime among black youth has decreased over the last two decades, right? So as the number of black households that are led by single parents has gone up, the crime has decreased. So this disrupts the narrative, because what some would have you believe is that as the number of single family households increases, that the number of black violent crimes would increase along with it. Now, by no means am I advocating for more single parent households. That's not my point here. But the idea being that the narrative that we oftentimes are fed is that these folks here are the problems that exist in our communities, because they typically have children who aren't educated, who commit crime, who are basically problems in our neighborhoods. So part of what I'm asking us to think about is, how do we begin to engage in research that challenges the traditional narrative? How do we begin to raise questions that begin to put a spotlight on those topics that are typically overlooked and not examined? We know what the problem is. We've talked about the problem for years and years on end, but at some point in time, as educational policymakers, educational researchers, we have to begin to sort of challenge this traditional way of thinking about what happens when it comes to experiences of black students. I mentioned earlier that what we know now is that the number of black enrollments in higher education have reached an all-time high. That is frequently not part of the conversation. Are the numbers where we want them to be? Of course not. But we look at the number of acceptance rates at some of the most selective colleges and universities across the country, black folks are getting access in ways that they never have had before. You look at the sheer numbers of students who are at UCLA's and Berkeley's and Stanford's and the Ivy League's. We have never seen that number of students at the levels in which they are. But part of what we have not unpacked is, why is it that so many don't have access to this, right? So as I'm sort of working through, trying to talk through what this means, I'm beginning to think about the fact that there are some other issues at work here. So you look at the gender discrepancies. What we see in the black community is that black women have continued to make some significant gains in terms of post-secondary education. We saw the shift occur probably in the mid-80s, where black men and black women were attending college and graduating at comparable rates. But over the last 20, 25 years, the number of black women who are attending colleges and completing colleges is continuing to grow leaps and bounds beyond where we see black men are. So I think we need to ask ourselves, why don't we put as much what's happening here, right? What is happening in schools and neighborhoods and homes that explains that? Now, I believe on some level, and I don't have any kind of scientific data to support this, but I think that there's something that happens in K-12 schools. I think what we do know is that 90% of all teachers in K-12 schools are women. Overwhelmingly, they are white. I think there's something that happens in schools, especially when it comes to the ways in which white teachers interact with black males, that I think we have to sort of, you know, interrogate. I think that oftentimes these are feminized spaces that oftentimes are at odds with the ways in which black boys sort of think, act, compute, process, communicate, and the like. But at the same time, I also want to say that this number here should be and could be higher. So what is happening with black women? While they're making strides, we still see more black women who are not getting access to education compared to those who do. So again, part of this is I want us to think about, how do we sort of shift the spotlight to look at these counter narratives that are beginning to sort of challenge the traditional way of thinking. Now, I was part of a study that was done by the Children's Defense Fund about 2 years ago that looked at the ways in which adults and caregivers see the state of affairs for black children. And what we found interesting from this research is the fact that, much like I said a moment ago, these are the best of times, yet the worst of times seems to be echoed by adults who are in the process of raising black children. And what you see here from this data, without going into too much of the details, right, we see overwhelmingly that there are a percentage of black parents and caregivers who believe that these are very tough times for black children, and they recognize that, right? But there's about a 20% say that these are okay times for black children, and a small fraction, probably less than 10%, who say these are very good times for black children, right? So what is going on with this 10% here, right? These are the 10% I would maintain who are finding ways to gain access for their children, who are finding a way to get their children access to AP, who are finding a way to get their children into college and universities. So the argument becomes, what is the role and what is the responsibility of the 10%? And some of you might know where I'm going with this, because we have this 10% who consistently does well, who consistently seems to perform, who has somehow figured out how this whole process works, right? So with that, I think this kind of leads us to Du Bois' notion of the talented 10th. And so I'm sort of trying to make some sense out of this idea of what is going on with this 10% that gets access, and what are they doing to somehow bring along the additional 90%. So Du Bois posed the question over 100 years ago: the Negro race, like all races, is going to be saved by its exceptional, he said men, I'm going to say men and women, okay, so I hope it is mine, and we got to be gender fair here, okay? He says the problem of education then among Negroes must first of all deal with the talented 10th. Folks, that is us. That are the folks in this room, okay? He says it is a problem of developing the best of this race, that they may guide the mass away from the contamination and death of the worst in their own and other races. So therefore, the challenge has been laid. The gauntlet has been put forth. What do we do, right? And he finishes that statement by talking about the fact, did the college graduates, again, that's us, with all their fine theories of life, really live? He poses the question, are they useful men? I would put women in there too, right? Are they useful men, women, helping to civilize and elevate their less fortunate fellows? I think that's the call for us who continue to have access to these institutions. What are we doing, right? How do we begin to sort of disrupt the narrative in ways that says that those who do have access are helping to bridge the gap between those who do not have access, right? And I think there's some things we can do to begin to get at that. And I want to talk about some of those briefly, then allow for some Q&A. So first and foremost, I by no means don't think that we continue to sort of dismiss the fact that there are some structural inequities that are in place here. I think we've got to put a huge push on improving public schools so that they are safe places that prepare children for the future. I think we've got to look at criminal justice reform, because far too many of our young men find themselves in incarcerated spaces. We have a project going on right now with the California Endowment where we're doing research on young men between the ages of 14 and 18, black males who are system involved, and some of the stories that they tell will tear your heart apart in terms of how these different kinds of infractions have not just short-term ramifications for them, but long-term ramifications. These young men find themselves in juvenile detention centers. Once they're released, there are no advocates to help them re-enroll in school, re-enroll in the neighborhoods, and it increases the likelihood that they find themselves back in those same systems within a 2 to 3 month period. We also are finding that a disproportionate number of these young men are in foster care. So again, that's another system that is full of holes in it that doesn't give these young men an opportunity to really be viable. And the part that's really unsettling, and we found this a couple years ago when we went out to Challengers Boys and Girls Camp out in Lancaster, the detention center, I was blown away by the number of young men, black young men under the age of 15, who were already fathers. So then we begin to see the cyclical nature of how these kinds of hopeless circumstances become about. So I think we've got to push on looking at how structural and institutional changes can take place. Unfortunately, you can walk into lots of schools across this country where black children attend, and they tend to be be nice with my words here. I don't want to ruffle feathers here, right? But they tend to be staffed by some folks who should not be doing this work. Is that a nice way of putting it? I was going to say something else. But they tend to be staffed by folks who I don't believe have the best interests of children at heart. Being at a school recently, Fremont High School, it was heartbreaking to see something like 45, 46 students in a classroom. That just does not promote learning. It does not. And it becomes normalized, and we accept that as sort of business as usual. So I think there's got to be an ongoing struggle to push back against structural kinds of issues that put students at very distinct disadvantages. You look at per pupil expenditures. Even here in California, we rank 48th in the nation in terms of how we fund schools. But even within the schools within the state of California, you can look at LAUSD that funds some schools at about a rate of about $9,000 to $10,000 per pupil. But then you've got some more affluent areas, public schools, that are close to $17,000 to $18,000 per year per pupil. How do we fund schools at different levels, but yet we expect you know, similar outcomes. It's just not going to happen, right? So there's got to be a pushback on structural and institutional changes. The other piece I'm looking at is there's got to be a community response. I think anytime we have seen these kinds of transformations, there's been a community pushback, right, where folks have said that something has to happen different. Where you've got healing black families, connecting fathers to their families. Part of what we find with these young men who are system involved, almost 99% of them do not have fathers in their lives, right? It's almost a recipe for disaster when young men, and I would also contend young women, don't have positive male role models in their lives. So we've got to find a way to help connect these young men with resources, agencies, individual mentors, and the like that are doing this work. I know they're going to be a little bit uncomfortable about this, but I think what we have to recognize is that there are folks who are disrupting the narrative. The Fishers are here. If you don't know the Fishers, can you raise your hand, please? I'm sorry, I'm putting you on the spot here, right? Raise your hand nice and high. If you want to see a place where the narrative is being disrupted, go see the Watts Learning Center. Right in the heart of Watts, where kids who attend that school come from Watts, and they defy all the stereotypes. These are kids who are performing at the highest levels possible. Gene, tell me, what was the API this past year?
For 870.
870, right? And this is for students who are low income, many of them being raised by grandparents, foster parents. Am I right, Ms. Fisher? Right, but what you see is a commitment and an investment in community where you have people who say that something different can happen with children when there's investment and agency on the part of community. So we have examples that work. We know this is not rocket science at the end of the day. We're not trying to figure out what works. We know it works. We have examples right in our communities. The issue is, and I'm not going to go here, but when we look at the middle school, some of the challenges that you have to deal with the middle school, right? Folks continue to still throw obstacles there, but despite that, there's still this persistence to make sure that students reach academic excellence. Yeah, turn it around, absolutely. So, I mean, I think these are some ways in which you have a community challenge that says that we can have young children who can succeed if you've got the right kind of pieces in place. And then at the end of the day, this third point here is about how do you build a movement, right? This is the talented 10th. I make the argument, how does the talented 10th help to connect to what I'm referring to as the neglected 90th? Right? We've got 90% of our folks who have been more or less neglected, and I think we have to find ways to connect black leaders, academics, and activists to the work that's happening on the ground. I don't think we can keep ourselves sort of nestled in these institutions of higher learning. We can't stay in the ivory tower. Many of you know what I'm talking about because you're already doing this work, right? There's got to be a way of taking what information, what social and intellectual capital that exists here, and find ways of connecting that with folks who are oftentimes not able to access that capital, right? And so then it's about building a comprehensive strategy, talking about how you make this a more of a holistic approach. It can't be education alone. It's education. It's got to be health services. It's got to be mental health issues. It's got to be all kinds of ways in which we bring multidisciplinary approaches to begin to mobilize in ways that helps folks address this problem. So what needs to happen? Again, I cannot stress enough the importance of research and inquiry on issues related to the black experience. And so many of you are doing that. I think our research has got to help inform and enhance and improve the realities that we see happening in schools and in communities right here in our neighborhoods. And if we're not doing that, I think we should be asking the question, then what are we here for? All right? I mentioned a minute ago about connecting the talented 10th to the neglected 90th, right? Because I think this chasm is getting wider and wider in ways that almost has a lot of these folks feeling as if we have completely neglected their concerns and their realities in ways that I think can be warranted based on many of their experiences. And again, I think that the black intelligentsia, for lack of a better term, and this is, I think, what Du Bois was trying to get at, needs to assess its role of advocacy, obligation, and commitment to black people, problems, and potential. So while Du Bois talked about the talented 10th, I also would push back on that because I think there's some who have critiqued that idea to say, well, what are we defining as a talented piece, right? So what makes us talented and the folks who are not here not talented? So in some ways, I would sort of evoke Carter G. Woodson's idea of miseducation, that maybe our notions of talent have come from this narrow paradigm that says that folks who have college degrees are the ones who are talented. I think that paradigm has to be turned on its head. And in some ways, maybe it's the folks who are not here who are the talented ones who have found a way to be resilient and who have shown resolve to continue to sort of push up against some of the sort of the intellectual and institutional barriers that have been placed in those spaces. So I think our role is to engage in work, research, advocacy, policy that begins to challenge and begins to articulate the ways in which we have folks in these communities begin to talk about their realities. Last slide, then I want to open it up. So what do we need? And this is my educational sort of background coming out, but again, what we see over and over again, equitable resources matter. So from a policy standpoint, there's got to be advocacy to ensure that all children have access to equal resources, equitable resources, I should say. Equitable being very distinct from equality, right? Because we know if you give the same when you've already got discrepancies, you'll continue to have the discrepancies, right? The second point, about well-trained teachers in every single school. I will continue to say that the research bears this out. When you see students who have turned around, when we see academic improvement and growth, arguably the single most important factor in that whole equation is to have highly skilled, highly trained teachers. What one trained teacher can do who's well trained is just simply phenomenal. On the flip side, what we also know, and research bears this out, 1 year, just 1 year, of an underprepared, underqualified teacher can undo 2 years worth of growth for a student. And that's why teacher quality is so important. But unfortunately, where black children tend to attend schools, they tend to have some of the least qualified, underprepared teachers. Hence, we see further backsliding on the academic performance. So if I had $1 million, that's where my money's going, to putting teachers in classrooms who are well trained and who understand the needs that African American students have. It makes a huge difference. I was just telling Mr. Fisher, I was over at the middle school just a couple of days ago, and for me, many of you know what I'm talking about. You can walk into a classroom, Ms. Fisher, you know what I'm talking about, right? You walk into a classroom, it takes 15 seconds to know if a teacher really knows what he or she is doing, right? 15 seconds to walk in and to get a sense that, you know what, learning is taking place here, because you can feel it, you can see it, it's just palpable when it's taking place, it's powerful. Conversely, you can also walk into a classroom, and I walked into West Adams High School last week, and it was just the opposite, where you walk in and chaos is ensuing everywhere. And the question we have to ask ourselves is, why is it that our children continue to find themselves in those schools where chaos is the norm, as opposed to those sites where teaching and learning is the norm and it's expected and it happens on an ongoing basis? The third point, there's got to be a focus on learning how to teach challenging content to diverse learners. Cannot stress that enough. Part of what we see when you have well-trained teachers, they're able to challenge kids who have a wide range of skills in terms of how they learn. Part of what really I think we have to understand is that we cannot take a one-size-fits-all approach to teaching and learning. And part of what we do in schools is we say, well, if you can teach middle-class white students, you can teach all students. And I challenge that notion, because I think there are some different cultural norms and ways of being that have to be taken into consideration. The fourth point here, about coherent curriculum focused on core concepts and inquiry within and across the discipline. Bottom line is, we have to teach children how to think critically. It pains me to walk into classrooms and there's just what I call the ditto sheet sort of routine. Dittos all day, every day. Just busy work, low level tasks, no instructional discourse, no higher order thinking skills that are being developed, right? You can walk in schools where you see teachers teaching and these are the things that they're doing. Even the students who are lower performing students are still being challenged to think, to articulate their ideas and thoughts, to begin to sort of dissect concepts, hands-on learning, right? Learning that's engaging. What we hear over and over again from students in schools, especially black students, some of the most highly capable black students, they say that school is boring, right? School is boring, right? There's nothing here that's relevant. There's nothing here that's thought-provoking. There's nothing here that's exciting. There's nothing here that's stimulating. Now, I'm not saying that we have to entertain black students, but I think that teachers have a responsibility to engage them in the learning process, okay? Fourth point, the idea that performance assessments that guide learning, teaching, curriculum, and management. Again, performance assessments that guide learning. Why do I stress this? Because you walk into a lot of schools and it's test driven. We're teaching to the test around the clock. We've taken all autonomy away from teachers and said this is what you must teach, how you must teach it, when you must teach it, all being guided toward the test. Assessment is important, but assessment should help to inform us about what students know and what they do not know, not to be given strictly for the sake of saying that we test kids. We think somehow more testing means more rigor, and I disagree with that. The idea that schools are designed for student and teacher learning, again, part of what I always tell my pre-service teachers is that you should look at yourself as someone who is going to be learned just as much as you hope that your students are learned by you. It's got to be a reciprocal process, right? Some teachers have this approach that says simply, I am the all-knower, you must learn from me, there's nothing I can learn from you. When I was in the middle school just a couple days ago, so I'm giving a plug, I forget the teacher's name, what she was doing, she was teaching feudalism. Feudalism, right? And she engaged these students in a, I thought, a very thoughtful way of, she had them inform her about how they would think about feudalism within a contemporary context. These kids, I think we're seventh graders, were phenomenal. Key concepts about feudalism, what are some limitations of feudalism, how does feudalism not work in contemporary time, what roles did we see peasants play in feudalism, on and on and on. I mean, content that's rich, where they got to talk with kids across these concepts and ideas, where kids, I mean, here's where you see kids learning. When the bell rings and kids don't move, right? They're still engaged in the learning, right? That means something is taking place there that they find meaningful and valuable, okay? And the last one here is the one I think is most probably important out of all of them, right? I don't know how we mandate this, but I think this is so critical. You've got to have committed, concerned, and caring educators. I mean, there's no other way to put that, because once you have committed, concerned, and caring educators, they take care of all the rest of this stuff here, right? Part of what we struggle with here in Southern California, we get folks who decide to enter teaching until they can find a real job, right? I really don't want to teach, but I want to sort of teach until I can figure out what real career I want to embark upon, right? Or I don't want to teach, I really want to act, but I can't get the acting sort of situation right, so I teach until I get my big break, right? Or I really want to sing, but until I get the big contract, right? I think we've got to be very sort of upfront and explicit about this, and this is what I tell my folks over in education all the time. The problem we have with schools is that we let too many folks in who we should not let in. And my thing is, it's easier to keep them out from the very beginning as it is to try to get them out once they're in. And I maintain that the teachers that we see who are doing harm by all children, when we see that, there are red flags that happen way before that time. And so we've got to be a much more stringent body about who we let in. I think we've got to ask hard questions. We got to probe folks about, why do you want to do this? What is your commitment to this? How do you see these children in relation to your reality? Because the litmus test I ask educators all the time is, do you give other people's children the same commitment, care, effort, and energy that you expect to be given to your own children? And I'm convinced that we have far too many educators who don't do that. They give other people's children something that they know they would never accept if it were their sons and daughters. And so I think we've got to be very clear and careful about who we even allow in schools, who we allow in classrooms, because the problem then becomes we have a devil of a time getting them out, right? And we have unions that will protect incompetence, and we allow people to continue to do harm that is oftentimes irreparable on behalf of our children. So you get folks who are committed, who are concerned, and who are caring, I think you begin to disrupt a lot of what we see happening in schools. And I think that in some ways even goes beyond the dollars and cents that you put into schools. Part of what we know from segregated schools in the South is that while they may not have been funded at levels that their white counterparts were, but they had far more committed, concerned, and caring educators there who helped to overcome the obstacles that were in place that allowed those students to be successful. So I will shut my mouth there and open it up for any questions and answers we might have.
While you were talking about the talented 10th, I was waiting for it to flip it on its head because I'd already written it down.
Okay.
I struggle with that concept, only because it sometimes becomes this us and them.
Yep.
I am the talented 10th, therefore I'm a black intellectual, and not thinking about those lived experiences of the everyday black
people.
And so when you were talking about flipping it on its head, I was thinking that perhaps we think about the talented 10th as the people who are conscious and recognize that there needs to be change in the community, and the 90% of the folks who aren't on board yet don't think that there are some things that we need changing. So that talented 10th can be the educated folks, it can be people who didn't, you know, make it to college, but they recognize that there is something that we need to do. I think that actually that consciousness is where the struggle is.
So I'm on point with you. I'm just not of the belief that the 10% believe that there's something that they need to do. I think perhaps the consciousness is perhaps the talented 2, right? The 2% of that 10 who is kind of concerned with that. And I'm not saying that every person of color, or every black person needs to be committed with issues around black folk. I think they should, but I understand folks have free will. But some folks don't believe that that's their responsibility, right? I have issues with that, but the idea being that, you know, this so-called talented 10th folks, these folks who get it and other folks who don't, I think that these are the 10% who have gotten access, right? And who all have only gotten access, I maintain, this is the point that's oftentimes missing, they've gotten access because of the sacrifices by those who did not have access, right? And how quickly we forget. It's the whole Clarence Thomas phenomenon I refer to. But anyway, you and I on the same page now, Michelle. Go ahead, Darnell.
Yeah, I want to go back to a point you made in your talk. I really appreciate the talk. You raised some really important issues that are very relevant in this moment, all the challenges we have in education. And you were talking about structural and institutional barriers.
Yep.
And you know, you kind of referenced the time before integration, when there was segregation. So some of our most talented teachers, but because they had no other opportunity, taught in our high schools and middle schools, and so we had people with PhDs, famous people, teaching our students, and we had kind of community investment ownership of schools that led to outcomes that some might argue are better than what we see today in terms of dropout rates. You look at a school district like LA Unified, that's largely Latino and African American. It has pretty abysmal statistics in terms of what our students do in the system. So I guess my question is, given the reality of the day, where we have public school systems that are largely African American and Latino, and in some cases are so large and bureaucratic that you wonder how you can kind of take hold of sort of individual high schools when there are all these mandates about what must be taught, test and everything else that goes on. How do black communities organize themselves to kind of make the types of interventions that you've been advocating and to make those interventions stick and make a difference? The struggles as we speak going on Unified that, you know, are struggling to try to figure out what their place is with this much bigger monolithic system. Obviously we have charter schools and private schools that have managed to find the right formula. But is that the ultimate salvation, or is there a way to kind of reform public school apparatus as well?
See, so I think there's been a shift that has occurred. So when we talk about what schooling looked like in the segregated South, and again, folks have written about this, there was this belief amongst many black parents that said that my goal and responsibility was to get my children to school, and teachers and educators took care of the rest, right? So I didn't have to be as concerned because I know the folks I turn my children over to have their best interests at heart. And I think that mindset unfortunately still exists today, that my goal, my job as a parent is to just get my children to school and the school will do right by my children. Right. Well, I'm of the belief that that day no longer exists. And so the way in which I think any reform has to happen is when you have parents who understand that they have to take a greater advocacy role on behalf of their children, right? I continue to be blown. I was at Cochran Middle School this weekend. There was a parent event put on for black parents, and they were expecting close to 300 parents to come. They had put this all-out blitz to get parents to come. There were 7 parents who showed up, right? 7. And the idea was that parents feel like schools will take care of it, right? Schools will take care of it. And I think that mindset has got to shift in some way, shape, or form. I think when you look at schools that do something different, I keep referencing the Watts Learning Center, you can go there, you will see parents there on a regular basis. Grandparents were there, right? So the message has to be articulated to parents. You've got to play a greater role. You've got to demand better. You've got to expect certain kinds of outcomes. And I think charter schools are one venue that can happen, but I don't think charter schools alone are going to fix it. It's got to be a greater sense of advocacy and urgency on behalf of black communities and for black educators to help inform black parents about what roles they have to play. Even though I think schools create this real sort of this kind of difficult sort of pathway to navigate, so even if parents want to advocate for their sons and daughters, if I'm a black parent and I'm not really, all I've got is a high school diploma, I walk into a building and the very people I've got to interact with have far more knowledge about schools and things of that nature. So it creates a very sort of tense field relationship. So I think that until you see some real sort of groundswell of parents being informed, number one, and then taking on an active role to understand their role in how schools should and could operate, I think it's going to continue to have this kind of challenge. And part of what disturbed me with LA Unified, I think black children have been kind of looked at as kind of a minimized population, right? They're only 7% of the district, 8% of the district. But I frequently raise a question, you know, you and I have talked about this and worked with folks on this. LA Unified almost has 700,000 students. So even at 7 or 8% of the population, black students are still close to 60, 70,000 students. So if those students alone were their own district, they'd be something like the 13th or 14th largest district in the nation. So we're not talking about just a couple hundred students here who are not being serviced. We're talking about over 50,000 students who are not being served, but I don't think that their parents understand the roles in which they can play to push back on some of the things that we see in place in schools. So it's a hard one. Sarah.
Yes, one of my concerns is you mentioned the exorbitantly high percentage of white teachers mm-hmm. in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
So in terms of TEP programs, I'm not sure what's being done outside of UCLA's TEP mm-hmm. program to foster more, I guess you could say, cultural empathy
yeah.
or understanding here, but I think that it's in terms of improving the manner in which these teachers are engaging with particularly black males and mm-hmm. black youth,
mm-hmm.
there's got to be a conversation that's starting perhaps at the college level before
mm-hmm.
they enter
mm-hmm.
into TEP. There's mm-hmm. got to be some mm-hmm. sort of engagement mm-hmm. or dialogue
mm-hmm.
about
mm-hmm.
what it means to be racialized,
mm-hmm.
like to live
mm-hmm.
in that reality,
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
it affects the daily mm-hmm. microaggressions mm-hmm. and all different sorts of effects, structural
mm-hmm.
effects that it
mm-hmm.
has on
mm-hmm.
black youth.
Mm-hmm.
If they don't have those basic understandings,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
then there really is no way for them to enter into the
mm-hmm.
conversation and engage with authentic compassion and empathy and understanding.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So of course I'm right there with you. So I think the problem is twofold. One, we need to find a way to increase the number of black teachers who are in schools. That's a hard thing to do because, as Darnell mentioned, 50, 60 years ago, we saw huge numbers of black, principals, teachers, and the like. But as opportunities began to expand, we had lots of black folk who left the profession. So I think we've got to figure out how do we get black folk into teaching as a career field, right? So I'm looking at Bree behind you, so she's one of the folks who's going into teaching, right? So we got to get more folks into the profession. But I think equally as important, and you could also argue even more important, that while I want to see more black teachers in the field, I want to see more prepared teachers in the field, right? Because black alone does not mean prepared. And I have unfortunately seen black teachers who are not equipped to teach black children. And we just have to put that on the table and call it what it is, right? So at the end of the day, if it comes to my sons and daughters, I want a competent, caring, committed teacher more so than a black teacher who's not committed, right? So I don't think the two are mutually exclusive. I think we have to fight for a more diverse group of teachers, but at the same time, we have to fight to ensure that teachers are adequately trained in how to work and teach across racial differences. What we know, and the research bears this out, that of these white teachers, most white teachers who are in the profession, most grew up in communities that were not diverse. Most have had limited interactions with diverse communities. So frequently when they enter into urban classrooms, this is the first time they've ever had any kind of extended exposure to non-white communities. So I think you're right in terms of having these teachers have a real authentic understanding of what racial and cultural competence and awareness should look like. Far too many teachers sort of employ this colorblind approach. I don't see color, I see children, right? Knowing full well you see these black and brown faces in front of you every single day. So there's got to be a real focus on talking about that. The problem we're having with that, though, in teacher education is that most of the folks who train teachers are white. So if we think that the teaching profession is white, then you should look at the folks who do the teacher education. That's even a wider population. So until we begin to diversify the folks who train teachers, we're going to continue to see this problem sort of occurring over and over again. We have the same problem here. I mean, some of my colleagues who I work with on a regular basis, we have these conversations. We're supposed to be a so-called more progressive program. The idea being that these are folks who I think are well-intentioned, well-meaning people, but who just do not know how to have conversations around race, do not know how to have conversations around culture. And if they're preparing the teachers, the idea becomes you don't have to think about this, you don't have to talk about this, just treat them as children and everything will be fine, despite the fact that these children will tell you every single day that their realities are being shaped and defined by their racial experiences.
Tyrone, how do you see programs like Teach for America and such relates to your topic? Because I see them come here every year,
mm-hmm.
And they recruit.
Yep.
Just what is your thoughts on that?
All right, so I got to pick my words carefully on this one, Alex.
You're at home.
I know, but I got to be fair. So I have historically had issues with Teach for America. And the reason why I've had issues with Teach for America are tied to a couple of factors. The idea is based on the premise, let's go to the most selective and most prestigious institutions and find people there to teach, right? I didn't go to a selective or prestigious institution, so I guess I take some umbrage to that, right? So the idea becomes, let's go to Harvard, let's go to Yale, let's go to Princeton, find the best and the brightest, and have them do service work in poor communities, right? So that whole model kind of just reeks of a missionary kind of feel to it for me, right? And the idea also being that all we want you to do is just give us 2 years, right? Just give us 2 years. You don't have to do this for the long term. It kind of comes back to this idea again that this is not a real profession. Just do some drive-by teaching and then go on to make a bunch of money, right? So that's my concern with Teach for America. And on top of that, the preparation is not what it should be. Most training, they've gotten better. But most training for TFA is typically what, 6 weeks, 7 weeks, or something like that? I mean, we would never put medical doctors in a hospital to operate on patients with only 6 weeks worth of training, right? We wouldn't do that. So my thing is, why would we do that when it comes to young people and their education? However, I have to say this, Teach for America is a well-oiled and well-funded machine. They are all over the country. They are here on this campus. They bug me all the time. Can I come to your class and give a spiel about TFA? No, you cannot come to my class, right? You can find somewhere else. But the bottom line is lots of folks are going through TFA. And so I don't want to knock that. So what I tell those folks who go through TFA, and I know some folks who are very good teachers who have gone through TFA, is that you cannot rely solely on the limited training that you get through TFA if you want to teach. You've got to go above and beyond. And so what I see happening now is some colleges and some teacher education programs are partnering with Teach for America to ensure that these folks can get additional types of training that can help them to be equipped to do the work that they want to do. So I think, you know, I can't be as critical as I probably want to be, because I think that Teach for America is here to stay. It's going to be here, and we've got to find ways to try to make it better, because so many of our teachers who are in urban schools are TFA products. Yes, sir.
I think your talk title was in a post-racial. I'm going to quote Martin Luther King, who says that racism, say America is a racist country.
Yes.
And that we might have hit a few blows, but it's not dead yet.
Right, right.
I think that applies to where we are now. But you know, we took about 9 students to Costa Rica, and for that we wanted to have an understanding of the rainforest, and say, understand that more completely. But what it pointed out to me was sort of an ecosystem. And each of these institutions don't exist by themselves. Education, banking, or criminal justice, or anything. It all works together. And each of the families, I call it a biome. And each of these families exist in a larger ecosystem. And they all have pressure on the family. And in the family is pressure on the student. So if, in fact, we were to say, go to a time where, in fact, homes, families were more involved in the education of their children, then we could say all of a sudden we could have homeschooling in a public environment. So you have the resources, say paid for by the state or wherever you get the money from, but yet you have, say, the drive, the will that you've talked about, the commitment and the caring that has to be generated from somewhere. Now how we generate that is the big question, because every day there are people who run away from poverty. Nobody's attracted to it ordinarily. Those who are deeply committed to the outcomes of making a difference. As the trees grow, they all fight.